Let's get started again. This will be a panel discussion. And we will discuss expectations and outlook for Tokyo's role as a global financial city. We have a panel of experts. Let me have a pleasure of introducing to you our speakers, Professor Hiroo Ichikawa, Professor Emeritus, Meiji University, Professor Tokyo University Executive Director, the Mori Memorial Foundation. We have Mr. David Semaya, Vincent Tokyo Ambassador, Executive Chairman and Representative Director, Sumitomo Mitsui Trust Asset Management. Ms. Chie Ito, Representative Director, Fino Lab, Executive Officer, Dentsu Research Inc., Assistant General Manager of Financial Solutions Division and Head of Business Strategy Unit. And this panel will be moderated by Mr. Hidekazu Ishida, EMP Special Advisor of Fin City Tokyo. Please give them a big round of applause. Thank you. Well, thank you very much for joining us after a very productive session in the morning. And we had to discuss the current play of International Financial City Tokyo. What are the appeal? What is the appeal? And what are the remaining challenges that we need to overcome? So those are the points that we would like to discuss with our experts on this panel. So I would like to share with you the feedback of Fin City Tokyo activities and what are how Tokyo is assessed by people overseas. And Mr. Ichikawa, Professor Ichikawa of Mori Memorial Foundation, will discuss from an urban perspective, real estate and urban planning. He is an expert of. From that perspective, Mr. Professor Ichikawa will discuss a current status of Tokyo, and Mr. Semaya will discuss from a financial perspective international financial city Tokyo's current status, which will be followed by fintech, startup support, frontline. We would like to invite Ms. Ito of FinLab to discuss what are the leading innovation initiatives that are taking place, so that we can all talk about the appeal and challenges of Global Financial City Tokyo. We want to shed light on Global Financial City Tokyo from different perspectives. Now, let me share some slides. These slides cover Fin City Tokyo's activities. I used to do corporate pension fund, so I have been in the asset management universe for more than two decades. And as you can see from how I talk, I'm not from Tokyo. I was born elsewhere. I'm from Osaka, and Osaka has always been striving to become an international financial city. But for the past 20 years, interest by foreign investors and the presence in the world in terms of market cap, number of unicorn in different metrics, look from different metrics, the status of Japan or status of Tokyo have been receding. Last decade or last 20 years or last 3 decades during this time, we have been, Tokyo has been on the verge of disappearing from the map. That was a major challenge we were talking about a couple of years ago. That was the bottom a couple of years ago. Yes, the situation has bottomed out. The worst is behind us when it comes to asset management and capital market. currently in the mines, the first change you would see is a financial startup emerging managers role will be the canary in the mine, and that will be the best place for us to foretell what's in store for us. I'm sure this was discussed already, and I know that much of misperception has been dispelled. But they start business. Emerging managers to start when they see a fish. So they are the ones who know the best where the fish are. Asset owners are like Coromant Masters. And there is a partnership with Coromant Masters and Coromant so that the Coromant will find fish, which pond, which reservoir, which area we should choose. Asset allocation managers are to decide, because Coromant is in a better position to know where the fish are. Emerging managers in finance, equity, active, hedge fund, those managing listed shares is something that you may think of. But more recently, private equity, buyout, or venture capital. In those areas, we are seeing emerging managers. I mean, even in comparison to the West, I believe there are quite a large number of new or emerging managers in that space, in those spaces as well. A Japanese market has been characterized as a bureaucratic nature, bureaucratic institutional investors, and they tend to prefer established financial service providers that are established with strong long track record. But this is starting to change. Asset managers should be willing to try out new things, and we need to incentivize them. And asset managers so far have been charging fees, and they have been focusing on trying to get as high a fee as possible. And the lack of emerging managers has been one of the factors why the financial and capital markets have been stagnant in this country. But this has changed quite a significant way. And outside Japan, generating alpha utilizing emerging managers has become one of the core strategies in the West. But when it comes to Japanese asset owners, even amongst the Japanese asset owners, there are those who are active in using emerging managers. This is most evident in private equity space, particularly in the buyout space. Those listed companies that do no longer have a significance of listing should decrease. I mean, Japanese market is unique in that there has been no decrease in the number of listed companies. I mean, there is so much you can do in trying to reduce IPOs. So listed companies, which used to be emerging companies, with those those do not make sense keeping listing, going private, and putting them back on the growth trajectory is one of the strategies that are sought after. So we have been focusing on trying to promote emerging EMP. And we oftentimes hear that Japan is lagging so much behind. But believe it or not, surprisingly, foreign asset owners have come to notice that it might be a strong demand here, because private equity, particularly buyout, is quite active in terms of emerging managers. Toshiba, the case of Toshiba, I'm sure you're all familiar with that. The case of Toshiba deal was led by JIP, it's an endowment, U.S. endowment, a very famous U.S. endowment has injected capital to establish AIP. So investors domestic and abroad have invested since the start of the JIP, so more than 10 years ago. This was a beautiful case of emerging manager, JIP used to be. And the JIP won the Toshiba deal. The endowment and foundation market in the United States and other leading investors are now getting serious about the buyout market in Japan or the reform. They have now high expectations that finally the Japanese reform initiatives can take off in a serious way. And that is why they are increasingly interested in what's happening in the Tokyo market. And from overseas, outside interest in Japanese EMs, there is a growing interest from abroad in Japanese EMs. And looking back on history, we've conducted interviews of a little over 20 investors, and amongst them, what emerging managers they have used in Japan. More than 10 years ago, as you can see, listed equity strategies were dominant, but gradually we have seen increase in private equity and Japanese venture capital. If you ask foreign investors, the bar is high for venture capitals, hurdle is high for venture capitals in Japan, but now they are retaining venture capitals in Japan, even. So the country of rising sun, that it's no longer the case. It's like a country of setting sun. But I think the assessment or the evaluation of the Japanese market is now catching up with the reality. And that holds true for the EMP in Japan, which is at the cutting edge in terms of selecting asset managers. And that's an observation from the ground I just wanted to share with you. So why don't I now invite Professor Ichikawa of Mori Memorial Foundation to discuss the topic from the city's perspective. What is your take on this current status in Tokyo? Thank you very much. I'm Ichikawa. I'm an expert on cities rather than financial services. So how does Tokyo look in terms of from perspective of cities? And the new analysis we started this year, so that is also something I would like to share with you during my presentation. So the power of city, since 2008, we have conducted analysis and six important functions of cities, economy, R&D, cultural interaction, livability, environment, and accessibility. These are the six angles, and we analyze the comprehensive power of 48 major cities around the world using these six yardsticks. And Toshi, correction, Urban Strategy Research Institute, headed by Professor Takenaka. And this was started in 2008, this study, GPCI. There are different assessment of cities, but there is no objective yardstick criteria, I was aware. Therefore, we decided to start a new initiative. We wanted to the top-notch experts to join us, and since 2008, this was started in Japan. This was started in Tokyo, and this ranking has become a landmark once immediately after the announcement of the first results. And this ranking, GPCI, is being widely used. And we are looking at 48 cities, so almost all the major cities are covered. We started with 35 cities, but we have gradually increased, and at the moment we cover almost all cities around the world, 48 cities. That's the latest count. So what are the six areas or functions? Different functions have different weights. So in terms of economy, there are six indicator groups. And we analyze based on 6 indicator groups, and each indicator group are divided into 2 or 3 indicators. And you assess whether R&D is low in terms of weight. But in any case, we are looking at these indicators, indicator groups and functions. We use 70 indicators. Roughly speaking, 9 indicators are constructed by conducting interview questionnaire survey, and this is all available on the webpage of Mori Memorial Foundation, where you will be able to find results. This is the latest result, which was announced in November last year, and London number 1, number 2 New York, and Tokyo comes in 3rd, followed by Paris in Asia. Singapore is number 5, and Brexit, Europe, Amsterdam has increased its position partly due to Brexit. There are yearly changes, but this is where we are. According to the latest report, London topped New York in 2014 when London hosted the Games. And this has remained intact since then. Tokyo used to be number 4, but due to the Games that we hosted in 2013, Prime Minister Abe announced that we are going to host, and that was the reason why we topped Paris. However, the 2020 Olympic Games were postponed by 1 year. So although the expectation was high as London, but Tokyo has remained 3rd. So there is a significant gap between Tokyo and London, New York. These are strengths and weaknesses. Of course, each city will have strengths and weaknesses. If you are focusing on deviation value of 65 or more, there are 15, and deviation value of 50 or less, less than 50, there are 23 indicators, lower than global average. So, for us to discuss, identify challenges that are faced by Tokyo, this gives you a very important reference point. Now, strengths that are becoming stronger and strengths that's deteriorating, and the most problematic is bottom right, 17 indicators, where it started as a weakness, but it is becoming even weaker. Deregulation, high tax rate, there are a lot of criticism, but Japan's move is very slow. And this is a weakness, and these weaknesses are deteriorating further. So where to change, which one to focus? There are little things that can be done by the national government and the Tokyo Metropolitan Government. I'm involved with Tokyo Metropolitan Government discussions, therefore. We are trying to boost the economy. It's not easy, but the cultural exchanges, cultural introduction, there's a lot of things that we could do, so we are focusing on trying to change that and improve that. So where is Tokyo in terms of economy? Tokyo is down to 10, number 10. Weak yen is one factor, but there are different factors why Tokyo is struggling to improve its rating. In the middle, there is a chart. In the case of New York and London, they have strengths. London in particular have a lot strong cultural interchange, and New York stands in R&D and cultural interaction. Tokyo has no particular strength, but somehow it's ranked number 3. There is nothing that stands out, but Tokyo is managing to keep its number 3 position. So how can we improve the position of Tokyo? We cannot just sit back and look at Tokyo deteriorating in terms of its ranking. So we now added the 7th function, that's a financial function, in addition to the conventional 6 functions. So financial centers and financial sector angle, or the function, was added on top of the existing 6 functions. And as you may have discussed, Tokyo, Japan, is trying to improve its position. And what will be the likely position of Tokyo if and Japan when it is successful? Therefore, indicators, FX, rate market, highly skilled talent, backup functions, financial intermediary and financial investments, those are the 4 functions. And these are the 4 functions based on which we will analyze financial functions. And there are 4 or 5 indicators in each of the indicator functions, and we are talking about 48 cities around the world. It's not easy, but somehow we managed to do this, and for the first time we announced the results. So using these data points, we want to use this as a foundation for our discussions, which will be focusing on the specific. And we disclose what we actually used in detail. And if you could go to the Urban Strategy Research Institute of Mori Memorial Foundation website, you will find the details. What kind of data are we going to use to explain each indicator? This relates to this have an impact on the credibility. Since 2008, at GPCI have always been transparent about data. There are a lot of different ranking, but there are a lot of black boxes in many cases. So we avoid black boxes, and we ensure 100% transparency, so we disclose the details of our indicators. This is the ranking in the financial sector. What stands out is that New York and London stands out in terms of their rankings. So data explains what we have known. But Tokyo is ranked number 3, managed to be number 3. And within the top 10, we have China. Beijing, Shanghai are there as well as two of the top 10. And different cities have different characteristics. New York's strength is up and bottom. So a lot of trading volume and mechanisms to back up the trading volume, very strong. London is completely different. FX market, very strong in London. So bring capital from outside and sending out capital from London to outside. So London is a typical case of a global financial market. So bringing in capital and taking out capital. So although London and New York are highly evaluated, the content or the strength of New York and the strength of London are completely different, as you can see. So what about Tokyo? Completely different. Unlike Tokyo doesn't have London or New York strengths, but Tokyo has capital, a huge pension fund in Tokyo. I mean, we all know that. So in a sense, we have a lot of potential in Tokyo, but unless this capital moves, nothing will change. Beijing. Turning to Beijing, not much strength to talk about. Perhaps more banks they have, but the situation is close to Tokyo. What about Shanghai? There are some strengths, but the size is not that big. Hong Kong, the power down we have witnessed, it's balanced. International financial market strength. And a competitor in Asia for Tokyo is Singapore. It's close to London, and they are bringing in capital and sending out capital from Singapore. That's what makes Singapore different. Tokyo, New York, London, when compared, you can find that the patterns are completely different amongst New York, London, and Tokyo. So what is the definition of global financial center? Tokyo. When you say Tokyo is bad because Tokyo doesn't have London and New York functionalities, but looking at into the future, if Tokyo capital starts to move, this may change. And if you do look deeper, this is a detailed analysis. Three major cities. Turning our eyes to Asia, you may think that Tokyo is lagging behind in a significant way in Asia, but the international capital market is the weakness that Tokyo. But if Tokyo can do a better job, we can be much better. But the situation amongst Asian cities are almost the same. Tokyo is not the only laggard. So having known these things, what Tokyo should do, what other cities are doing. I mean, those are the things that we need to look at to come up with the policies for Tokyo. Seventh, so what about the comprehensive power, GPCI plus financial center? There is a wider gap between London to New York and Tokyo. in two cities, Shanghai and Beijing, come in. So my conclusion is that we need to analyze what we are going to do about the weakness, which is deteriorating. And I'm an expert on Tokyo, so I'm very much interested in Tokyo, and I am trying to give advice to policy advice to DMG. But how are people outside Japan looking at the cities? We ask questions to the residents of cities, and Tokyo ranks number two in terms of places they wish they want to work. Those in yellow are in Asia, so people in Asia want to work in Tokyo. But they don't come to work to Tokyo, though they want to work in Tokyo. So this is something that we know, and this could be a good reference point for us to come up with a set of policies to improve the situation of Tokyo. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was very thought-provoking. Ranking accordance to the capabilities of the cities. There are many questions I'd like to raise. Perhaps I could take a couple questions at a later time. Moving to Mr. David Samaya, could we have you intervene, please? Mr. David Samaya is Executive Chairman and Representative Director of the Sumitomo Mitsui Trust Asset and also Ambassador of FinCity Tokyo. And both inside and outside of the countries has a lot of knowledge about asset management companies. And in FCT, we are greatly indebted to him.
Ishida-san, and first of all, I want to thank FinCity Tokyo and everyone for the opportunity to be here today. It really is an honor to be with esteemed panelists and to be on the first panel this afternoon in what looks like an amazing agenda later on. The timing, I don't think, could be better given the announcement about Japan-led asset management country, and we'll hear about that later. I'm sorry, I'm speaking in English, so for those who need to use the translator, please do. I'm David Samaya. I'm a chairman of Sumitomo Mitsui Trust Asset Management. I'm also ambassador for FinCity. I first came to Japan way back in 1980. And for people to say that Japan hasn't changed, I'm happy to debate them about that because I think there's been amazing change since when I first came. I've been here, lived here on and off for 27 years. I've also lived in London and New York. And so the previous presentation about global financial cities very much hits home. I've experienced all three of them. I would say the professor mentioned Nantonaku, Tokyo is number three. I don't think it's Nantonaku. I think frankly we have the best food in the world, and that will push us up, and the most safe society here. Maybe earthquakes come in a different category, but in terms of safety and ease of living, Tokyo really has a lot to offer. But I'd like to confirm a few points. The overall title of this morning and this afternoon's conference is an inflection point of an international city. And I would like to say that absolutely, we are at an inflection point, not only for Tokyo, but for Japan. And I think we're beyond the inflection point for the Japanese equity market, because I do believe on the investment side, this time is different. And the reason I'm saying this is, as chairman, one of my responsibilities is to be an ambassador for the company, as well as for FinCity, and I do a lot of travel internationally. Over the last 2.5 years after COVID, I have traveled extensively, Europe, the Americas, Asia, even Africa. And I will say, I returned to Japan from London in 2014, observed the tremendous changes in corporate governance that we've seen in just the last 10 years. And talking to international investors, comparing, let's say, 2016 to this past year or past couple of years, I will say that in all continents, all investors overseas have an unbelievable interest in Japan now. The level of interest in Japan I haven't seen since I go back to my old days, 1987, 88, 89, when I was a trader and salesman at Sanyo Shoken, right up the street here in Kayabacho. And so the level of interest in investing has really soared. And we're seeing that with inflows, actually, into the market. It isn't just about talking anymore. We're seeing those investments. And Japan is now being viewed as corporate Japan is being viewed has dramatically improved corporate governance. We have a new corporate governance code. The Tokyo Stock Exchange has come out with a focus on PBR. And, you know, we all know that things take time to gain a consensus in Japan takes time, but we have that consensus now. And investors are seeing not only the benefits in increased earnings per share by Japanese companies are sharing those profits more in higher dividends, stock buybacks, but we're also seeing a feeling that the Japanese economy is finally emerging from 10, 20, 25, dare I say 30 years of a deflationary spiral. And finally, we're at the point where companies are increasing salaries and bonuses. Of course, we need a few more years of this to confirm the trend. But finally, we're seeing Japan coming out of what was a very, very difficult time. And in addition, as I said before, everybody is interested in coming to Tokyo, coming to see Japan in the winter, skiing. Prices are so low here. It's safe. People are very hospitable. But I want to emphasize it's also viewed as a place to invest in. My recent travels last fall to Australia, where Australian institutions have rarely invested in Japan, many potential investors were asking me, okay, how do we start again to research Japanese companies? We haven't researched Japanese companies for years, but we really would like to begin to research Japanese companies. And 3 or 4 years ago, I would visit Europe, and the first question to me wasn't about Japan, was, David, what do you think of China? What do you think of the Chinese economy? When I go to Europe now, nobody asks about China. They all want to know about Japan. So I don't have a presentation. I don't have a lot of details and facts, but the mood and feeling the mood of the room as I do. Last year I was abroad for 86 days, almost 3 months. I'm telling you, there's great, great interest. And by the way, just ask Warren Buffett, who has invested 2 years ago and again last year, who feels that there's great value and great opportunity for growth here in Japan. And this interest is in both listed equities as a result of, again, the changed attitude of corporate leaders, what I call a more balanced equity or shareholder-oriented business approach, making much more efficient use of capital, a sharper focus on growth opportunities, and returning the capital to shareholders via dividends or share buybacks when there aren't opportunities. If you don't have the opportunity, you give it back to the shareholder. This is very, very different from the business approach, traditional Japanese business approach, but we're seeing these changes. And I will reiterate, Japanese corporate profits are not only up by earnings per share. Of course, you can reduce the number of shares, your EPS goes up. In aggregate, profits are at an all-time high. And what I would like to say is, to sum this up, the metabolic rate of decision-making in Japanese companies is going up, not going down. And I think we see that. It's by necessity. Faster decision-making. Sometimes it's hard to see when you're a part of it, but when you step back and have a look and you ask overseas shareholders, do they see a difference? They will tell you, absolutely, we see that difference. In addition, there's huge interest not only in listed equities, but in Japanese real assets. And we see that, especially in real estate, coming from Asia, the ultra-high net worth investors who view from China, from parts of Southeast Asia, who view Japan as a very stable, law-abiding a country where their assets are safe, where they can depend on them being there today, tomorrow, and in the future. Accounting rules are of a global standard. And from this perspective, Japan geographically is in an amazing place here in North Asia. Interest in private equity, as was mentioned, real estate, as I said, infrastructure, and as well as now sustainable assets related to ESG. Japan has a lot of technology, clean water technology, all kinds of precision tool technology that applies in the sustainable field, lots and lots of interest from overseas in these areas. And lastly, and we're going to have a presentation in just a moment, given the reforms and given support from prefectural governments, the national government, and changes in society here. You know, the internet and social media, we all think it's bad, but actually there's some good things about it. The startup scene compared to just 5 years ago, 10 years ago, is thriving. There's an ecosystem that is growing and being built, plenty of opportunities for capital and human capital embedded in large Japanese companies, for people who want to leave those companies, raise money, set up new companies, and list them. I think the number of IPOs on the Tokyo Stock Exchange has been very, very robust for the last 4 or 5 years. Great opportunity there as well. So again, the metabolic system here in Japan, I think, is on the upbeat. And so with a new focus on the asset management industry, San Unyo Rikoku, an asset management-led country, and there's a lot to be discussed, but we heard it from Nakaso-san and others, and we'll hear it later on. I think there's a fantastic opportunity for Tokyo to make a big leap forward and to move the needle. And to do that, in the quest to continue and expand its role as a global financial city, which it is a local, regional, big city, but really to attract people. I think what we need to be talking about is how do we get people who are in Singapore, who are in New York, in London, to really say, you know what, I'm gonna up and move to Tokyo. That's the real question. And the opportunity that the professor mentioned, Mr. and Mrs. Watanabe, as we say, or Mrs. Watanabe, the proverbial trillions of assets still sitting in bank deposits at 0% interest or 0.1% interest. If we get this government-led asset management initiative going, and one of the framework is now expanding with the NISA program, which was 6 million yen, now to 18 million yen, there will be that demand. And we have to continue. We can't stop there. We have to look at DC limits. They need to increase. We need to do more education in financial education in the school system. And we also need to strengthen the asset management industry. You can't just do all this and the asset management industry isn't strengthened. We need a strong asset management industry. And to do this, and by the way, the institutional trillions and trillions is there. We now have a new university endowment fund. So that focus is fantastic. To get people to move here, I really think the Emerging Managers Program is really important. And whether that is traditional asset management, private equity, venture capital, sustainable capital, real estate, and I know there are some people in the audience who are also representing the ecosystem. So that's asset servicing, law firms, middle and back office services. All of these areas really need inward investment from abroad, as well as focus from us domestic players to identify that this is an amazing growth opportunity. So that Emerging Managers Program to help facilitate, by the way, Singapore had almost no asset management industry 20 years ago, 15 years ago, look at it now. And that was on the base of the Emerging Managers Program, and we could talk about other locations in the world have done really well. So, and this will bring in experts who will work with Japanese experts, and we have plenty of Japanese experts in asset management sitting in companies, but we have to unlock that value, unlock that value. So what do we need to do? We need more focus on this, and forums like this are fantastic. I'm sorry to say, even though I speak Japanese, we need more English language, because if you want to attract people in this area, we've got to have the ability to communicate and do business in the language. We need more schools, more capacity in legal firms, more capacity in a number of areas in the ecosystem. We need more flexibility. We really do. We have to be more flexible in our thinking, open minds, more insights, more innovation. I didn't mention IT. We need much more IT. And IT needs to be used to make our industry more efficient. It should be something second nature to us. I don't want to be critical, but you know, you go to a forum like this in China, and nobody is using these translators anymore. Everyone is on an iPhone, and they're getting simultaneous translation on their phones. All of this leads to what I say, a higher metabolic rate, faster change, and that really is important for us to not only keep number three, but to move up. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Semaya. So regarding the issues and points raised by Mr. Semaya, of course, we would like to get back to them later. But as the last member, Ms. Chie Ito, Representative Director of Finolab. So she will be talking about fintech and support for a startup from someone on the ground. Hello, everyone. I'm from Finolab. I'm Representative Director. My name is Chie Ito. And from a startup's point of view, what is the status of financial investment in the world and in Japan? I would like to discuss that. And we hope to have some time for a panel discussion toward the end. That should be most interesting. So I shall try to be brief and talk faster. So the status of Japan's fintech. We Japanese tend to think that we're no good, Japan's no good. But that is not necessarily the case. There are many startups that are being set up. Investments are made into these startups. Many financial institutions are engaging with startups to generate innovation. And the amount of investment 2 years ago, although it went down, but in line with the views of the VC Association and others, over the middle to long term, it's going to grow linearly, positively going forward. And major stakeholders, well, Japan, there's JFSA, BOJ, there are regulators, and of course, investors, startup companies, industry associations, financial institutions, various stakeholders when it comes to building an ecosystem. I think we are one of the most successful countries in building this type of ecosystem around the world. So JFSA, TMG are providing lots of different support. And there are a variety of startups being created. We talk about fintech, but there is so much variation when it comes to fintech startups. And which are the areas that are active? They include settlement and payment, but I will not go into these details today. And fintech communities, Finolab, that I represent, well, within the globe, there's Asia. Within Asia, there's Japan and Tokyo. And we would like to create a healthy fintech community. And so we create communities for startups And there are also communities that are led by financial institutions. So there are a number of initiatives to build these communities as well that are happening in Tokyo and around Japan. So PhenoLab, who are we? What is it? For over 20 years, I was in a financial IT industry. So large financial institutions, remittance and trading systems. For over 20 years, I was engaged in developing those systems. Starting from 2014, I became responsible for the fintech sector. Dentsu Real Research Institute. So it used to be called ISID. It's now called Dentsu Research Institute. And 2012, since that, they have been hosting a fintech pitch contest. I was there in 2012. And Money Forward got the award. And they had great funding. In 2 years' time, we had a financial solution team. And in 2 years' time, well, they've grown into a team of 300, very successful. So I've seen such success examples, many of them. So create a solid ecosystem that will lead to the creation of new industries, new sectors. So that is something that I've been working on and my firm is working on. I have a few more slides, but I would like to skip them in the interest of time. So far, why is there a prospect for success for Japan's fintech ecosystem in Japan amongst all the countries in Asia? Well, that's because of the health of the financial system. And on the technology side, there are many excellent engineers available in Japan. So finance and technology, we have both. And if they can come together and ecosystem built based on that can grow successfully, I think Japan can be a promising market for Asia. And that was the starting concept. For about a decade, now that I've been engaged in this for over a decade, the ecosystem for startups, compared to 10 years ago, I think the ecosystem and the environment have developed much further. It's now better compared to a decade ago. But having said so, there are still a number of challenges outstanding. One such challenge is a supply of risk money. Well, we are seeing increasing range of VCs, different types of VCs are emerging, but we need to do more. We need to do a better job in increasing VCs. At the end of November, early December, Slash was held in Finland, a very large startup conference in Europe. I went there, but the fundraising for seed investment and the time, lead time up to the actual investment, the amount of seed money given is too small, and the timing of decision is too slow. I hear that there are complaints about that in Silicon Valley as well. So those are some of the areas that we need to improve on. And mobility of human resources. This is not restricted to fintech, but from large companies to startups, mobility of people between the public and the private sectors, I think we need to see more mobility. With increased mobility of talents, we will have better understanding of each other, and that will expedite growth, I think. And just like sports, entrepreneurs need to increase in number, I think. So VCs, of course, there's Silicon Valley. Well, entrepreneurs become angel investors or VCs to support their successes, their junior colleagues. They're not providing just advice. They provide hands-on support, referring customers and providing fundraising support
they provide very practical advice and support, and it may take time for Japan to catch up. But here in Japan as well, I think we need to foster more of these entrepreneurs. And in the future, going forward, the market environment is becoming somewhat tougher. So compared to the first generation of fintech companies, the cases that our fund is supporting, it seems that the services and companies that we support are becoming smaller. So we want startups to grow out of Japan and become global. That's what's most important, and that's what we would like to do. Thank you.
どうもありがとうございます。
Thank you. So whatever time is left, I don't think there's much time, but let me ask additional questions to each of you. First of all, Professor Ichikawa, as you've said, Tokyo has been unfortunate. Tokyo has a lot of capital, but go outside, or the capital only went to those people who are rather rigid in comparison to other financial cities. The work-life balance is quite good. It seems that there is. And don't mean, I mean, if you look at FinCity, attracting financial institutions, if you're doing that business, they know that, but the first priority of them is to make money. They have to be profitable. Positive work-life balance, the cleanness and livability. I mean, Tokyo may not have been successful in earning the credit there. But large companies are now focusing on improving work-life balance to improve productivity. In the longer run, balanced cities may be more productive. And asset management, fund management is not an exception. From the business perspective, the attractiveness of a city and when the city's attractiveness, when you quantify, it seems that there is no, you may not answer. 1.5, Tokyo is not good in terms of work-life balance. Tokyo has a good urban space. So as Mr. Semaya said early on, Tokyo City is very stable and it's very safe. And city space and top-level architectures we have in Tokyo. When you want the financial system to work, livability can be improved. For example, Azabudai Hills, which was completed recently, I mean, it provides an environment which is favorable for non-Japanese workers, and they also have international school there. What is lagging behind is financial mechanism. Yes, we are working on that, but the tax system is not global level. At global level, we need to fill the gap, but we do have infrastructure and a lot of good food, and this is like a shopping heaven. So, and the life-work balance is not good. So for those who work, we do have a lot of infrastructure, but we need to make sure that we overcome challenges as a mechanism. Yes, we have started. We are working on that. But what is the level, globally speaking? To what extent, how many years will it take to complete? But Japan has been making efforts gradually. The three-year COVID pandemic, what was the lesson that we learned? What was the outcome? So people started to travel abroad when COVID started to recede. For 3 years during the COVID period, we all learn that Tokyo is safe and stable. So people outside Japan are focusing on Tokyo. China is going down. So the timing is good. The timing is ripe. London is top, New York number two, and Tokyo is number three. However, the gap is widening between number three and 1-2. So there is a potential for us to improve Tokyo. So I think it is, we are at a very good, we have a big opportunity. So timing is now, timing is ripe. So the timing for us to improve is now. Well, what do you think, Mr. Temaya?
I can't agree more. Is the
because there are many, many opinions, and I see many friends and colleagues, former colleagues in the audience who lived in Japan, who don't hold Japanese passports. If we want to attract people to come and work in Japan, at a certain level, I think the infrastructure in Tokyo is absolutely fine. For example, young people out of university to come and live in a small 1DK apartment and commute, that's what they have to do in London, that's what they have to do in Paris, that's what they have to do in New York. Maybe if they're expatriate in Hong Kong or Singapore, their commute is very, very short. But if you're looking to attract families who are mid-career, and they want to live in a reasonably sized apartment, there aren't any available. It's because of the ushinatta nanjunen, you know, and fewer expatriates, nobody was building foreign style apartments. And now we have this amazing boom in venture capital and fintech, and some of the best apartments the Japanese are moving into and buying. So if we really want to attract families to come as expatriates, you really have to solve the school and the housing, and then of course there's the big issue that we don't talk about, and that's the tax, because taxes are very high here. But if we are looking, if we can attract younger people, 1 year, 2 year, 5 years out of university, I'm telling you, I have children in America, they're sharing apartments, they have tiny apartments, they pay a fortune. So I think we have to be very strategic about how we target who and what segment we of human capital we can bring in. But there is a scarcity of housing for those who want to come and spend 4 or 5 years or 7 years or 10 years here. We have to figure that out, yeah.
What's wrong with this?
Yes, the timing is now. This is very important. And one thing which I found interesting among the things that Mr. Samaya said in terms of Japanese asset management, it's the real estate industry that apply for registration the most. The REIT, private REITs, half liquid, half private vehicle. Asset management and managers try to register this, and this is the largest number of registration. And I believe that this is being invested within the confines of free cash flow within the company. Most of this is real estate investment funds from Asia, and I believe in Japan we are a target for these. And so, as a foreigner, you choose to live in Japan. And also, Ichikawa-sensei talked about from the standpoint of industrial or urban engineering, Japan's a real estate investment or real estate investment from Southeast Asia or East Asia. Will that change Tokyo and the nature of the city?
I'm a member of World City Committee, so I sometimes travel to Singapore. And if you go to Singapore, you find out that the prices are soaring. And it's a competitiveness of Tokyo. Tokyo is better. So last month I went to San Francisco, vacancy rate is 30%. But if I went to Silicon Valley, booming incubation, new companies, new startups, and there are a lot of investors, young entrepreneurs. So the answer is there. So the time is right for us to do what needs to be done, what we should do. So you're asking this, right? Tokyo has a lot of potential and capacity. But there is no strategy. You have to have a strategy. Someone has to come up with a strategy, and someone has to execute the strategy. That's clear. But we have not been able to do that. But this is the only timing. This is the only opportunity. What was your question? I fully agree with you.
People around the world want to come to Tokyo. But we're so slow in preparing all that we need to receive them. And there's a shortage of people. What to do with that? Well, the world trend is to introduce immigrants, foreign workers, and we're so slow in preparing for that. Well, urban development is ongoing, but with work-style reform, we can't do too much work. And so general contractors, their construction work is stalled. No one's asking about that. That's because of work-style reform, people say. So from the viewpoint of international competitiveness, you have to review this. So who's going to do what? What should be at the forefront? Well, we have to do what we need to do.
How about from the standpoint of investment, Semaya-san, do you have anything to say?
I want to give you an interesting observation. Let's take a look at the opportunities in winter in Japan. What are they? Everyone loves, well, maybe not everybody, but so many people love to ski. And we had a big boom in the bubble years, and we had all of the development and all of the mountain areas that have been ignored for years. But for the last 15 years, there's this strange place in Hokkaido called Niseko. And before Niseko was found by Australians, I believe, it was a very small village, and nobody had any idea that it was worth anything. But you happen to have individuals who are very focused on skiing and a certain kind of powder snow. And they found very inexpensive property, and they built and created something from nothing. If we think about Japan, Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Philippines, mainland China, Singapore, Indonesia, Thailand, Australia, New Zealand, I'll even go as far as India. The upper middle class population of those countries combined over the next 10 years, I have seen figures of 300 million, 400 million, 500 million, 600 million people who become upper middle class change their wants, desires, needs, and skiing becomes one of them. The desire to ski. And of that population, it's estimated between 50 and 70 million people will be a population of skiers. And where in Asia can they go to ski? They can go to Korea. Korea has ski opportunities, a bit in China. But where is the most opportunity? Here in Japan. And where's the food the best? Here in Japan. You can go to Canada, you can go to Colorado, you can go to Utah, you can go to Courchevel in France or Switzerland, but Japan has a great opportunity. And when you talk about property and real estate, well, if you come from a country where you're not so sure about your assets and you like skiing and you're upper middle class or you're high net worth, you know what? I want to buy a property in Japan to ski. So I'm just painting a scenario of opportunity for growth. And the challenge for Japanese people is how to best manage this going forward. I think your European friends, we have people from France and from Switzerland and other countries. We see this in Europe, where you have people living in other countries. They buy villas and they come and they visit. It's an opportunity, but we have to change our way of thinking in Japan. It's no longer only industry. We're in a post-industrial time. And how do we make the most out of our natural resources and our natural geographic position? And it's just one example of opportunity going forward, in my humble opinion.
Ito-san, the attractiveness of a city, from that perspective, I would like you to talk Silicon Valley in terms of livability. I mean, it has been the center of technology investments. It's huge, right? And other cities pale in comparison to Silicon Valley. And other cities have all tried to emulate the Silicon Valley model, but without much avail. So it's a long history. So tech startups, starting tech startup in Tokyo. Why Tokyo? Why would technology startup would choose and pick Tokyo? The government is sending venture capitalists to Silicon Valley. I mean, that's what the government has been doing, sending off Japanese venture capital to Silicon Valley. I mean, venture fund, you should go outside Japan, invest outside Japan. So that is, it has become a common sense amongst the venture capitalists in Japan. And that has to change. So what makes Tokyo unique? What are the things that you can do with scale being in Tokyo? What are the tech startups that can be successful and booming in Tokyo? What is your vision? Finolabo, when we started Finolabo, what kind of ecosystem in Japan we should have to support the startups? And we learned a lot from, not from Silicon Valley, but we learned a lot from London. Level 39 is in London. Level 39, FCA and financial institutions and startups. It's like a partnership between public and private. That's FC38, and we had a lot of we were given a lot of good advice from them. So we should not only turn to Silicon Valley. I mean, Silicon Valley has its distinct model and style, and that should be looked at. But not just Silicon Valley, but we should try to take lessons from other places. I mean, because it's very difficult to directly transplant what they are doing in Silicon Valley and Tokyo. So, as you've said already, I mean, we now have remote work, working from home, and even now, it's location agnostic. Startups don't care. I mean, especially the tech startups are not bound by a location, where to hire top-notch engineers from around the world. I mean, that's what they are thinking about. So they're not bound by location. They're not bound by Tokyo. As long as it's livable, I mean, inclusive of subculture, I mean, young foreign engineers may want to come to Japan because they are attracted to the subculture in Japan. So it doesn't have to be Tokyo. I mean, other parts of Japan could also be attractive. And Japanese engineers are also competent. And they should so global techs can be fully successful in Tokyo. But risk money? No. Talent, the talent mobility, the mobility of talent, that's the issue. And personnel management, human resources, laws and regulations, and you have to be a regular worker. I mean, not just overtime. How many overtime do you have to work, but the recruitment, employment practices have to be changed.
Thank you very much. We're well past the closing time. So we would like to start summarizing the discussion today. So urban engineering
a startup fintech. We heard from experts of these areas. So the status of Tokyo as an international financial city from various perspectives, we heard what they have had to say. As Mr. Ichikawa said, we have to act now. We have come to a point where we have to take action. And we are faced with this golden opportunity. So we have to capture that. And so that we can mobilize people, we would like to rally forces and work on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to all.